And we ran right out of tape on the end of this lettering. It's all spraying. We're going to put it aside to dry, and we'll pull up the masking tomorrow. Now, I got a real nice piece from a gentleman named Doug Wendt. And I'm just going to read this real quickly, by the way. This is an interesting little aspect of, well, of the late Miss Ashley. And he says he had quite an interest, he's a Reno Air Race fan, quite an interest in the plane, because local modeler Dick Alley, who worked all his life for Boeing and recently retired back here in Whitefish, Montana, did some of the design work and was on the pit crew. Oh, geez. Needless to say, he took the crash badly. It was a tough time after things had been going very well. Anyway, this is apparently one of the things. I don't have this, by the way, Doug, and thank you very much. I will treasure this. I will hang this up. In fact, I'm going to get a little frame for it. I don't have anything like this. And it gives a little history of the plane. Some of the sponsors are all around. Now, one of the things, we're right at the point in time where we want to see what some of these things say here. And we may be able to copy some of them with our Letra setting ability. But that's going to be one of the things coming up in the next week or so. But one of the things this would have been a real help on is the scoop shape. You can see the scoop shape, unlike a P-51 with a lip in the front. And the blisters. Anyway, Doug, I really do appreciate this. Doug also sent something that I guess is a cartoon that they hand out at Reno. I can't read the artist's name, but it's kind of cool. And it looks like the Red Baron. Yeah, it is the Red Baron. Anyway, with the contra-rotating props, and it's got Top Flight and Vico spinners and stuff, and a cotter pin holding the engine in and stuff. Kind of a cool little cartoon. Thanks a lot, Doug. I appreciate it a whole lot. This is from our friend Bill Farmer in Jackson, Tennessee. Some real nice shots. This is one of the computer-generated sheets that he sent me. And he sent some nice hard copy pictures that obviously we'll pass on to Stunt News. Looks like he's got a real, real nice Cardinal here. The thing that I thought was interesting is he copied the paint job after a full-scale Mooney. Finished as per your videos. Stalker Pro 61 rear exhaust engine. Anyway, I really like the paint scheme. I like the gold lettering. See, now we're just in the middle of doing gold lettering. Ironic. It's wonderful how these ironic things happen. Nice lettering job. Bill, I have to tell you, I like the lettering. Now here's another thing, another nice little detail he did. The detailing around the canopy. And of course my favorite view, the side view, the pilot's view, the classic Cardinal. From Bill Farmer, thank you very much. A quick couple of photos here from Keith Bryant. Obviously a P-39. The specs are Super Tiger 60, weighs 62 ounces with a 60-inch span, all built up. As of today, it isn't flown, but hey, he knows we love these semi-scale planes. Keith, awesome, and we will pass these on to Stunt News and get back to working on that lettering. Thanks a whole lot for everybody sharing the pictures with us. Okay, I always like to let these masks, or whatever you want to call them, dry overnight. It always seems like you get the best bang for the buck as far as pulling up the tape line when dope is 24 hours old or close to it. This looks like it's dried up okay. One of my little habits that I have is always work on the bottom first, and I will carefully pull off the tin foil and parts of the mask, and then we'll get busy seeing if we can card those edges down. Now one of the things I've always had good luck with, always, whether it's painting or inking or whatever, I always try to do the bottom first. The reason for that is pretty simple. It takes a little time to get your fingers working and your hands working, and at least it takes it for me. And in this case,
I'll get off all the tinfoil and really carefully pull back this mask. Now this is one of the things, you don't want to just rip it up. Anyway, I had an interesting, and I'll be sharing this real soon, I had an interesting conversation with Al Rabe this morning, and he has a friend in the area of the country where he lives that has some really tricked out paint techniques where he can paint a whole plane in 2 days, and guess what? He'll be sharing it with us. Look forward to trying to learn some new tricks from him. And as soon as I get that footage, I'll obviously see what I can share with you. The trick here is really go back nice and slow. See, the rubber cement is just releasing so far so good. Never say perfectly. Now the last step here, of course, is the same as in the lettering, is just pick up, you just roll it in a ball in your bare hand and swish it off the wing. So what's happened at the end of the last video and the beginning of this one is we've basically masked out and finished off the lettering for about a total cost of 65 cents. And we've had a good test now of the new Brodak gold, which is the brightest gold. That's why I'm trying to use it. I think this is going to be every bit as bright as the gold leaf lettering on Strega when it's the clear and all the accents on it.
The first couple times you do this, you get all nervous about putting that glue in it, but it comes right off. It's ordinary office supply rubber cement, of which there's about 100 brands, and they all work probably all made by the same company. Anyway, now when you're all done with this, and I'll do the rest of that off camera, you can see there's still some. Then I want to wash this whole wing down. I want to card these edges, even though these edges are, you don't even have to card them, they're so thin. Of course, the gold covered instantly. Don't need any carding, but I will take some M600 and clean this whole wing panel, because the next step after getting all this done is we're going to start inking up these letters. Now this not only degreases it, but any extra little rough edges will... You don't even have to card this. The gold sprays so thin. And the thing that's nice about it is we want to put a thin ink line around it and the shading and shadowing. Well, obviously the thinner this is, the better it is. And if you remember, if you've been with us on the videos, since the Strega project, the gold leaf was about an inch thick. And required way more clear than I thought was or would be necessary. Okay, once I get the rest of the foil off, this is ready to ink. Every year, this is one of the least desirable jobs in the world of model aviation. I mean, this is right up there with cleaning the fish filters and God knows what else. I have my set of pens, and I am going to spend the next hour and a half. Basically taking out whatever ink, there's none in there, but cleaning them, letting them sit in some hot water. I try to get the hot water here. If this doesn't do it, I'll boil up some water. A lot of times if that doesn't work, I let them soak in Windex overnight. Most of the time that doesn't work. And then what happens is I have to send them all off to Bob Martens, or I have to basically buy new ones. Now, I don't like buying new ones. You see, there's part of this that, I guess it's like it's a macho thing. You got to be able to get the old pens to write. Although it probably would be cost effective to just go buy another set of pens. Once you hear the clicking, you know you have a shot. So what I'm going to do, I won't do this on camera because we're ready to start inking a plane. But as long as you see black water coming out of them, you know you're doing some good. I've tried many, many things. I know ultrasonic cleaning. I don't know what the trick is. There's pen cleaners. I went and bought this $12 pen cleaner in the art supply store. It didn't work. And I have to tell you the truth. If I could find somebody to come in and just clean the pens for me every year, you know, I'd love them forever, man. It would just be like getting somebody to come over and clean the fish filters. But this is one of the jobs I really, every year I have to go through this. Now this one, it looks like we have it working. I won't know till I go to check it, but I take the little ink reservoir.
The reason you want to clean this is I want to soak this in Windex, and then I want to get a Q-tip in there and get all that gringe out of there.
Yeah, if you were a real draftsman, I don't even know if there are any real draftsmen anymore, but you would know there would be a routine, a ritual, and probably at the end of every day you'd clean the pens. Well, us modelers, I mean, we don't live by the rules, that's for sure. Boy, look at the stuff coming out of this one. And this is only the first one. I have seven to do. I have three with white ink, four with black ink. I like to vary the line size. And for outlining the letters, I need at least one thick one and one thin one. Now, it seems like, even before I hit this with the Q-tips, like the Windex seems to be cutting this. But believe me, don't look at this video and think, I'll figure some trick way of cleaning my pens, because I don't know what it is. But all I know is, yeah, we're getting there. You can half see through that now, but I'm going to get Q-tips in there. This is one of the things, without the pens being cleaned and all new ink put in them, you don't have a chance to get any kind of quality lettering. This is all the pens that I'm not going to use. I'm going to let them sit overnight in here. This is just Windex until I can hear that little check valve boiling. I've got all the pen parts in here. All the little reservoirs. Where's that little reservoir? See, when a reservoir is clean, you're supposed to be able to see through. There you go. But if you don't do this, now, I know what you're thinking. You're probably thinking, why doesn't he do this at the end of the building season? Well, I'll give you the reason. Stupid. Now, I know you're going to think this is a miracle, but out of those seven pens, I got three to write, and I actually got one of each size, so that, if I had three thick ones or three thin ones, I wouldn't be that impressed. We are inking. Now, the first thing, I want to figure out how thick I want to make the ink line around the lettering. Of course, I'm doing the bottom first. I have all my little plywood templates. So I want to get out the plywood template that would relate to the Miss Ashley. And over the whole top, I want to put an ink line. Now, the easiest way to do this
is dedicated
to
make a special breed who are bigger than...
A couple of tricks. I've got this all cleaned with M600. My hands are clean, relatively clean. Shouldn't really say clean, from 4 hours of ammonia. Now what I want to do is I want to just cover the line here, if possible. So I want to be able to move this, and I'll do one side at a time. You don't need to do the whole thing at once, that's for sure. Let's see if we can get this real close, if possible. I usually like to start with the thickest pen because the top part of every letter will be covered with one constant section line. Now I find, and again, I'm doing the bottom first so that I can develop a little technique. If I get sloppy, it'll be on the bottom. And I'm using the edge of the plywood here. Of course, I've put little pieces of tape on the bottom. In fact, I'll show that, so that the template doesn't sit down on the gold lettering, it kind of sits up just a little bit. Now, if you were a real draftsman or a real artist or a real, I don't know, a real werewolf or something, you could probably do this by hand. I can't. And I find the template a real convenient way of doing it. I can see, show you how bright I am, I forgot to do the first piece. I like to put on, in random spots, three layers of eighth inch tape will usually bring it up off the part just far enough, because you don't want to put a quarter of an inch under it either, and stay back from the edge just a little bit. Again, this is not ultra critical, but it takes a few minutes to do each one of the letters, and I guess I ought to stop and do them all at once so I don't forget again. I just go through and do three layers of anything. And what that does, it just like any inkline template, you don't want to have an edge. You want to have it that the little template that you're using as a guide is sitting up off the table or off the part by a very small amount. Now the other thing it allows you to do, and this is, I can see we already need to do this, is when you want to vary the line, let's say up here you want to make that go up just a little more, you can angle the pen. Instead of going this way, you can angle the pen back and just cover any little rough edge that you find. Now see how that holds it up off the edge? So when this is laying down, the ink doesn't tend to run underneath it. Now see how our line didn't cover? So when I go, the next time I'll put the template back and angle it back just a little bit, and it'll cover that right up. But that's how you correct little mistakes like that. That's what I said before, these templates don't have to be exactly right to a millionth of an inch. You have a lot of flexibility in the way you angle a pen. Now once I get one side done, I obviously let it dry, then I'll just move the tape up to the top and I can continue the bottom part. But like, the trick here, when this is dry, is to put the tape on here first and then take this tape off, then the template doesn't move. That's kind of a critical little thing if you want to do this type of lettering. Now with the tape on that side, I can go around this line. Obviously, the main thing is not to rush it. This ink takes about 10 minutes to dry. And while it's drying, I can move to the next little piece. Do the same thing. Do all the top edges. Move the tape to the top and do all the bottom edges. Then while that's drying, go to the next one. So actually, there's nothing about this that, well, there's no dead time in between. In the middle of inking, I turn around and Mike's got his cardinal here. Now we're going to take a little break from our inking regime. Nice canopy. Anyway, I think he's ready to spray the silver, and this will be another test we can use for that new spray equipment, assuming he wants to use it. Give it a test, assuming it's not raining. I think it's raining out there.
Yes.
It's raining? Oh. Okay, so let's see what you can do about maybe sand some of this out, or what do you have? Tissue on the back now? You ready to spray the silver, or?
Right.
Get the cowl done, get the little gear blocks.
See, this is what I did with that.
This is for the new cardinal.
Right.
Not the old one.
Right.
Mike did is he didn't recess the blocks as deep as they should be to put little covers on them. And I'm just trying to wonder if we could make a little hatch cover. Sometimes you don't get it lined up on the first, there you go. Or you could recess, I'm thinking if you could recess the little piece. I even have another idea, I think. We could solder a piece of tin onto the landing gear wire itself. You know, like the little cardinal?
Hmm.
Put it on the bottom and then put the two screws. Then you only need two screws. That might be the best choice of all.
Yeah, for this one, I think.
What might be a possibility is putting a tab similar to the profile cardinal on the bottom of the landing gear. See, what Mike doesn't want to have is the screws sticking up in those clips and everything. And then we could recess that piece of copper down in there, or brass or tin, because there's no force pulling on this. It could be right in the middle. I'm just trying to think, if you stay bright, solder that. Then with the tab in place, use the tab itself to mark this so we can recess it. Because it's a shame, all that work that went into finishing that, you hate to lose that. But that looks like, well, we'll find out once it's done, if that's going to be practical. We do this little deal of soldering these little tabs in place, and believe me, this is we want to line up the two wires. See, one, this one has the angle in it. Now take the other one over to the vise, Mike, and just bend it just enough that the two wires match, because once we get the two wires to match, then I want to get the two axles to match. If you don't do that, what I'm afraid of, since we've never done this before, is once we put these tabs on, then we're not going to be able to really get this nice and accurate. And I want to have it accurate. I want all the wires, all of that part done at this point in time. Right way?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. More than that?
Yeah, a little more. A little more. You don't want to bend this back and forth, but on the other hand, yeah, that'll be enough. Okay. Need a little fixture for making these because Mike may want to have another set of landing gear with wheel pants. And what this is, this is just a jig to hold this. You can see where I've marked it, so that he can solder these tabs on to several sets of gear. And it'll all be kind of interchangeable. Otherwise, if that tab is back or forth just a little bit, something will be a problem digging it in. Okay, we're letting the solder and iron heat up. Stay bright, silver solder. Okay, and before you do any soldering, of course, clean the wire immaculately. Clean the little tab, and we'll be ready to solder it. And then you keep this fixture forever and ever, right? Okay, we made these little tabs up on here, and I think this is, even though it's a stopgap way of correcting a problem, it certainly doesn't look like it's not going to work. Can you get the other one done?
Yep.
We marked that little area with a blade, and of course now we want to take that material out of there so that that piece drops down in there. And once you get the screws in there, Mike, I think that'll be fine. Do when Mike's done grinding the final little fit, we want to get everything sealed up with a coat of thin CA. Fit in real nice now?
Getting there.
And then we want to true the wires by laying a yardstick right across the two legs and make sure the two legs are in good alignment. Just keep picking up the little hard spot on that. I start laying this out, what's the first thing I notice? Let's see who can catch it. No dot on the eye. You believe this? There'll be no problem. I'll just back me at the end of the day. I'll make a little mask and spray the gold. Basically, I'm going around this now the same way. Any little lines where they don't match right up, I just need to fudge it in. But by taking that template and just moving that whole template down, Then I pick up this shadow line.
Now this is one of the areas we're having this plywood template really saves the day. If you try to do this by eye or by hand, it just never comes out as good as it does with the template. It is a relatively simple, straightforward way of doing your own creative, artistic lettering. Now Mike's in the final stages of doing his cardinal. We're finishing up the silver. We'll try those new spray guns on it. As soon as we get some weather, it's been raining out there on and off. Now once this comes off, and all these little areas in here, what I do, I keep the template here, and I kind of do them, actually, I just do them by eye. Good when you're going to fill in large areas to use the largest pen possible. This is a 1.0. Just seems to flow the ink a little nicer than if you try to do it with a fine pen. Now what happens is after about an hour into doing this, I start getting a little comfortable. Not real comfortable, but I get more comfortable. There's just something about it. I don't know what it is. And after the ordeal of cleaning the pens, the annual clean the pen ritual, the annual answer the phone ritual. Now, as I get all the letters shaded out, I like to do the big shading first, and then
This, again, I just do it freehand. I don't know any. I guess you could make little patterns and stuff, but I think if you take each little thing and do it undersized first, eventually you can just open it up and see where it's too wide, where it's too sharp, where it's too short. And don't forget the dot on the eye. Now, believe it or not, this photo that this thing from Reno that I got is extremely helpful because it's got the lettering laid out. And I'm trying to see if we've captured it. Hard to tell till we get it done, but... Now, what I do now is the last thing. I look at the picture here and try to detail in all the corners and edges with the real fine pen. Get all the little points, all the little edges. I'm kind of happy with that. And then, of course, we'll move over to... And maybe tonight we'll... I don't know. This took a lot longer than I thought it would, but... Yeah, we had Mike over here today, too. But try to get... At least get the bottom done today. One of the things I learned... That sometimes, and in this case, this is one of the times... It's easier to do this when it's a little darker. You don't have as much light reflecting. Now, it was just easier to do this with a brush and then go back over the ink around the edges because there's so many spots on this that if you were to make that stencil that narrow, it'd be really difficult to get it to lay down nice. Plus, this brings out the artist in us all. Now, when I was a young kid, this is a true story, my mother sent me to art school, and the teacher basically said, "Save your money, Mrs. Zertnowski, this kid has no talent whatsoever." Maybe she was right. I don't know about that. But it's this kind of detailing, and I can tell you for sure, it's this kind of detailing that when you look at those front row planes or those second row planes or whatever, the thing that separates them is that extra 100 hours of work that goes into this kind of little detailing. Now, I always find it helpful anyway. The model usually appears on... The way we usually view a model is on the floor or on the ground while we're standing up. So what I like to do is lay it on the floor and stand up and see how I like the lettering before I go on to the other side. Because obviously the purpose here is if I want to make any little changes or adjustments or something different, the time to do it is now. Now, it took a full 4 hours for me to shade this in. So rather than try to rush it or try to do less than whatever I think the best possible thing is, I'm going to put this away, come back to it tomorrow when I'm nice and fresh. But for a beginning, now, there's always time after it all dries. I put the little touch-up red spots in there to touch up the ink. What I've done in several spots is take a ruler and try to hit the straight lines with a ruler. Just a little detailing. And I put the dot in. I just haven't outlined it yet. Anyway. We'll come back to this tomorrow. It's starting to really look nice. I'm kind of happy with this. I say that over and over again, but I am. And the letters, one of the things I wanted was the letters to be like a family resemblance to Strega. Not, they're certainly not a carbon copy of them, but similar. Now we'll come back and work on this tomorrow. Now all that's left to do today is spend another whole day inking the top of this. I also have this little, where's my template? I'm glad I have this stuff already. I have my plywood template, and I want to put a line. Before I even start the lettering, I want to make sure. Attach that in place. That holds it down. Now I can get an ink line around that. While that's drying, I can get an ink line around that. Now what I like to do is just take the widest of the pens and leave the corners go and just come back in and get the corners in with a thin pen. See, by having these plywood templates, it really makes it, it takes a lot of the artist skill out of having to put, to try to put this line in freehand. Well, I know I can't do it. Maybe somebody who's been trained or has some other combination of talents can lay that line in without a curve, but. Now what happens when you try to get French curves and things to match these shapes, they don't always match. Okay, now the trick is, before you move the template, let the ink dry, because when you go in to move this, see, this is attached with tape now. When you go in to move it, it smears the ink. But while it's drying, I can take my define point and just lay in the points. And when doing inking, it's always important not to rush, let it dry. So while this is drying, I can go lay out some of the other ink work. What I try to do it, oops. Amazing. Okay. Now after a really heavy dose of caffeine, finally finished off the top, and we did not forget to dot the I. Now what I want to do, to the time I have left, and it's certainly not a lot, but I want to look at, and again, this is going to be real helpful, because look what's on this drawing, where the ink lines are. And I, to take that and some of the sponsors, I don't think we're going to put all that stuff on there, but just give an indication of it. But some of the ink lining, this will be real helpful. Now while I have the pen out, what I want to do, I wanted to show this too. See, there's some of the things on the back I can make up. In fact, I'm going to make this up in complete scale with a piece of plywood. That's something I can replicate very easily. So I can replicate. I can get a lot of this, or some of it, some of it, even the lines, the separation lines, as long as I have pens out. I'll see what I can get done on this with the little time that's left today. Now the first thing I want to do, I want to simulate, and I'm just picking things at random here to simulate. While we're doing ink work, I want to make up a little pattern. Of course it can't be to scale. That would simulate these, I'm sure, on a Learjet. Remember these wings, the wings on Miss Ashley really originated as Learjet wings. These are probably spoilers of some kind. So I want to just roughly try to scale it up in a way and make a template for this out of plywood. Same way we made the lettering. Pretty similar technology. First thing I usually do is look in my, I always keep a box with all the templates and little things that over the years I've used. Things that have, we've used these on a Spitfire program to lay out, I don't know, endless amounts of little shapes and sizes, and it's always good. For instance, that's from 1990, the Sidewinder. But I always think it's important to save all this stuff, because in a time like this, I may have one very similar to this. I won't even have to make it up. Well, doesn't matter. I don't have one similar. See, I lied. I don't know what we use that for. Anyway, we are going to have to make some templates for doing various ink lines. How many different shields I had over the years. Anyway, I'm going to get some 64th plywood and lay out the shape I want. did a preliminary layout. This is the extra plywood we had with the contact cement on. If the contact cement is facing up, it won't matter. All I'll do is get a scissor, cut this out, and real carefully leave the what amounts to be the hinge points in place. And all patterns that you would make, no matter which semi-scale feature you were trying to simulate, this is an easy way to do it with a pattern. 64th plywood is fine. Threw that first part away. What happened is these things, these little tabs, were getting to be, see how flimsy they are? So what I decided to do, rather than fool around, make up three pieces like this, and now I can, by looking at the picture, what this is going to allow me to do, of course. I don't know if this is going to work yet. But this is kind of the part that I enjoy, is that you really don't know if it's going to work. Now, see, by doing this, I can make this part longer and shorter. I can manipulate this until I'm real happy with the way it looks. Until it looks very similar to, let's get a look at the part we're trying to simulate here. These look a little bit further apart. And of course, then the last thing we can do before we hit this with glue is make sure all three of them are even. And it's little things like this, it's just little details. The next thing I'll do is run this up on a sanding block to make sure this is all very accurate. I like this way a little bit better. Then I need to put the tape on the back to raise this up off the part, and this will be my spoiler, little template for, well, this plane and any other one that I want to use this shape on. And it only took me a few minutes to make the pattern. What amazes me is how little you have to be off before it's obvious that something's wrong. In this case, just getting the template trued up, because in the ink work, your eye tends to pick up a little mistake very quickly. But anyway, this way it's much stronger. I have the grain going in the right direction. And basically have a much stronger part than the original one I started with. And any other pattern we make will be very similar, the way of making it very similar to this. I figured out pretty much the position I want to have here. I cleaned the whole area with M600. Didn't go back up over the ink with the M600, it was just cleaned around it. Ready to lay this out. Now I usually like to, when I'm going to do inking around silk span, somehow get this nice and solid. This always seems to be important somehow to, well, we can do it this way too. Now in this case I want to try to hold a pen completely 90 degrees. When I see a little spot that probably has a fingerprint on it, I just go move the pen back over it. Now the thing for doing all of these templates will be pretty much exactly the same. So any shape that you see or like on a, say, on a photograph, or if you make it up in your own mind, but I find in my own realm of taste, I like to try to simulate a real airplane. I don't like to, as an example, they have these templates for furniture and architectural things, and somehow when you put a couch, the outline of a couch out on a wing as an ink line, whoops, you always have two choices here. You can let it dry and scrape it off. In this case, I'll just wipe it off. But always best to use real aviation type of lining. At least I think something similar to that. Don't you love ink pens? There we go. Okay, now the other point is let it dry before you try to pick it up where you wind up putting little feather edges on everything.
It's always best to do a thin ink line first, because you can always make it thicker. We used the thinnest pen we had here. Once that dries, if I don't like the way it looks, I can put the template right back and just go over it with the thicker pen.
Now, if there's some little spots that haven't taken real well, obviously we'll go back and touch them up. Now, this corner is not right now. Another choice you have, and just do this by hand. Spot where you have a problem, isopropyl alcohol, not soaking wet, just the little hint of isopropyl alcohol will take off any smudge that you have. Now obviously what I'm going to do is key into the fact the middle of the little hinges mounts right onto the cap strip, measure this dimension to make sure I have it as far on a wing, and get the other one on the other side as symmetrical as possible. Now obviously there's a lot of ways of laying out the inking. Now in this case I want to do the trim tab, so I want to get that the little side view that I have, get a rough idea of about where that is on the real airplane. This is another way that I lay things out. You see, I can get it from this, I can get a rough idea. It's about almost halfway up. And now what I do is I lay out the outline of this. Just another technique. Obviously there's other ways to do this. Lay out the outline of what I want with eighth inch tape, and then do the inking using the eighth inch tape for a little bit of a guide. Laying it out in eighth inch tape first, I look at it, gee, needs to move up a little, down a little, bigger, wider. I can keep looking at it back and forth, moving the tape until I'm happy with the shape. Where if I were to just go in here with an ink pen or a template and say, oh, gee, I don't know. This gives me a little idea of where it's going to lay out. Now, obviously, I want to get as close to the tape as I can, say within about a 16th of an inch, but not touch the tape. And also, when I go to do the other side now, I can use this as my reference, and then I can just measure in here, and I'll have roughly the same amount on both sides. The rule is, and these are just these generic drafting things, the main thing is that they have tape so that the edge sits up off the part just a little bit. Now again, I don't want to get real close, I don't want to get where I touch it, but I want to play a little version of connect the dots here and see if I can get this on camera real well. I get almost up to the tape, because now when I do the line that's going to go around the edge, don't you love these pens? I can go back over the line, I can see this is not a real crisp line, real carefully. Now if you're working alone, another technique, and I use it from time to time, is just to physically put two pieces of tape on the ruler to hold the ruler in place while you're laying out an ink line. In this case, we don't really need it. Even better, if you have a friend, Mike may be over here later today, and we may work on this together where he can hold the ruler and hold the edges. Now, once that dries, I give it plenty of time to dry, then I'm going to run this line to the end, and then by hand just wrap it around, because these two have to line up. If these aren't symmetrical and they don't line up, when you look at it from this angle, you're going to say, oop. And when I get this line, I want to connect the dot if I possibly can. It looks like we got it. And kind of get it to wrap around as much as reasonable. I'll let that dry because I don't want the template smear in there. The trick is when you turn the part around, we want these lines to connect. So I need to take this and just be able to see it. If those lines don't connect, it's really going to look awkward. What I need to do here, I need to hold this up because I have that. I'm going to do these sides first. And using this front tape as my guide, I want to wrap this line right around if I can. Again, each time I do it, I'm letting it dry because I want that line to go right around. What's a question of? We want to make sure these two are just the same distance from the piece of tape and just want to connect the two dots with one of the straight edges. Now once that's completely dry, obviously I'll pull off the tape. Now another thing, if you're having trouble with the part itself, now my hands of course from machine shop work are all greasy all the time and oily, but the problem is you may get that the ink just doesn't want to stick to the part. Now a lot of tricks, one of the best ones Frank McMillan wrote about, and it's an excellent one, is rub the part with talcum powder and just clean it off, just ordinary talc, just wipe it off. The little bit that stays on just gets lost in the clear. It seems like we're a little bit better than average on this plane, that the finish is as far as the ink sticking. A lot of times that ink just wants to, you got to go back and forth 20 times to do it, but the talcum powder trick, wiping a part with M600, but don't wipe over the ink. Once you ink it now, from this point on, I really don't want to handle it any more than really necessary. Now that's about as close as, because we're obviously not making a scale model, but that really does give, and this drawing, believe me, I'm using this, putting it to good use right away here. There's just one of the features that show up on the side views relatively quickly. Now this one, I wish we could simulate this, but putting this out on the end of the flap, maybe I will, I don't know, that it's not going to look too busy out there. I get nervous when I get too many things. In other words, I like to get the center of detail in this area. Once you detail out here, I don't know that you want to concentrate area out there. I like it better when most of the ink and most of the detail is either on the fuselage, or the further you get from the cockpit, the less and less defined the details become. The next one we want to pull off this is this, the little, of course, the tip on bolt. So we want to get, I'll do the same thing of laying it out with tape, cutting one side, wrapping it around a little, and then going to the other side and connecting the dots. The first thing, I'll clean it up with M600 and hope that I don't have too many dirty fingerprints on it. Now I get real fussy at this point in time. I try to keep my hands as clean as possible for the last day or two that we're going to be doing this work. So every once in a while I'll run over to the sink and just wash my hands. But again, some people like to use rubber gloves, or they can use surgical gloves, or, well, it's real uncomfortable for me too. I just find it awkward using them. So I just try to be real careful. A line like this, relatively easy to do. What's important here is that they match up. If they don't match up, boy, forget it. Now, you see what I've done here? I made a little, I'll call it an error, but the pen slipped a little bit. Well, what I try to do is wait for this to dry. No matter how many times I do this, I always get one or two of these. Then I just let it dry first and scrape it back with a brand new blade. And you see, you can make it perfect. When you do it with alcohol, you can get it off, but then you have to redo the line. I want to do next, and I don't know if I'm going to be able to do this in a more scale or less scale fashion. You notice how the firewall parting line, where this, in a real plane, this piece comes off, of course, and the bottom comes off in like two pieces. But getting this line now, see on a scale plane, it's over the wing. I don't know, and I'm going to have to play with the tape. This is where the tape is handy, to get a spot that I exactly where I think that line will look the most scale without being scale. It's kind of a, you know, like in a mind's eye view kind of thing. It's actually, the truth is, it's actually easier to make a scale model. It's because you know exactly where everything should be. You don't have to stretch it and play silly putty with it and move it and whatever. For instance, on a scale model, you wouldn't have to worry that the flaps were here because this would be scale. Figuring out where exactly this line is going to go is definitely going to, and especially because I have two of these fuselages to work on. This is where it takes a skill called interpolation that probably Al Rabe is the king of, because he's going to look at something to make it look scale, but it isn't scale. And that takes a kind of a special skill. It's about using the tape method is, first off, I ran into a problem that I didn't anticipate. I can't have this come back on an angle because of the shape of the body. So the second choice is going to be to put the line there. And what I do from time to time is I try to use thicker lines on, from the nose forward, a thicker pen line, because in reality, those are the panels that come apart on a regular basis. Those are more defined lines. The ones behind here are really panel lines that almost never come apart or very seldom. So this line, when I lay this out with ink, I'll lay this out with the thickest pen I have. Lets you go back and forth, I mean the tape, before you actually commit to putting an ink line down. Having these flexible templates really comes in handy because I can tape this, make sure I have all the alignment that I want, and because we're going to try to do this in one circular line, this is possibly the most difficult of all the lines you need to do from time to time. This will keep it parallel. I remember doing these on a Spitfire. It was, well, it's not as easy as it looks. When you have a line that goes completely around a fuselage, that gets to be difficult. I look at it from every angle. And once I'm happy with it, by moving this line back, what I hope to have accomplished is, first of all, the idea is once that dries, it'll kind of make this separation line look like it's one of the panel lines. So I've kind of, in a roundabout way, cheated there. Guess I don't need the tape anymore. But as it goes over to fill it, of course, you've got to really be careful. And these are the thickest lines. The thickest lines on a plane will appear from here forward. From here back, we'll use the medium lines, and then way at the back, the thin lines. Now the next line is a relatively easy one. It goes right underneath the exhaust manifolds from the firewall to the spinner. Now I've had to move it down just a little bit because I didn't want it to run into this. I wanted it to look, again, this is an interpolation, but it has the same look. Now this is one, believe me, this is, I'm trying to get this parallel to the paint trim, and of course it has to be exactly the same as the other side to be, well, to be what we want it to be. Again, the trick of using thick pens and thin pens, various size pens, it really does add another, just makes it look more detailed. Look at this, I just blew this incline. But never worry. Ink is one of the things you really never have to live with. If you're not happy, you can just get alcohol. And not a wet Q-tip, but you can use saliva. Or you can let it come off when it's dry, it doesn't even matter. But knowing how to repair this stuff, I think, is important too. Because if you go into a project knowing, hey, if I screw up, I can fix it, changes your whole outlook. And I've had a lifetime of practice at that. Now what I'll do is I'll continue this by hand just so it kind of disappears into the spinner. Make sure they match. There's a little line right where the strake ends, but in our case, what I'm going to do is move it forward about an inch so it picks up this line, and I can use that as my reference and just trace up. Reason is I'm trying to disguise all these separation lines, and by having an ink line right run right into that, that might be a good way of disguising it. Help disguising it. Lay it out with tape first. Now it's going to end at this point here. We're not going to have the line go through there. Well, we're going to have to see how this lays out, since we're not doing it in scale proportion. But always having a tape so I can look down and see that I have it straight and level. And if I was even in doubt, I could take a 90-degree triangle. Since this line is parallel to the datum line on the plane, this should be 90 degrees. After doing this about four times, I decided rather than try to pick up that line, it just was too out of scale, that I'd kind of just move it back and go with having it that I wanted to pick that up, but I just, every time I looked at the picture and looked at this, it just didn't look scale enough. And because this is a low wing plane, getting this line in here is really going to make it look, it's going to make this dimension look even smaller than it is on the fuselage. So what I decided to do is make a pattern for this little piece in the back, and I'll just simulate this little piece without the part going around the fillet. Hard one to figure out because I can't, in essence, this should be a whole different shape if the wing were lower in the body. I'm just making up, again, same template, put the things on the back, same exact thing, and then it'll probably take me 10 minutes to figure out how I want to exactly lay it out. Thank Doug again for sending me this, and you can see how much I've used it. I've used this as my little Bible. Even though I have pictures, the Fred Cronwet pictures, don't really lay, it's hard to pick these up in a picture, so I really, really appreciate it. And Doug, I'm going to send you a copy of this video with my compliments. Enjoy it and pass it around. Again, this is just one of those things, and I don't know how to explain it. I go back and forth, changing my mind like an old lady at the shopping market. But I'm trying to use some of these lines to my advantage, that maybe I could get them to kind of disguise. Again, it doesn't have to totally disguise, but if I can do it, in essence, with free lunch. Now, this is a thin pen, because we're coming back from the nose section where the panels come apart on a regular basis. Now, I don't know on the real plane if this is a panel that would come apart for maintenance or... And I've put the tape on both sides because this is going to reverse itself on the other side, and then obviously I need to do this to two fuselages. This one I've really had to spend a lot of time interpolating because in our case the fuselage is much longer and thinner than a scale model. So I've kind of just used the same template I used here on top to give it a simulation. Now what I did, I want this in one size thinner line. Again, I'm trying to work off of that drawing to the best of my ability here. Now here's where we can draw on some of our experience working with the Spitfire. As you can see, these panels, and they're not a whole lot different than the Mustang, these panels are held on by Zeus fittings. So I'm going to get my riveting tool that has rivet laid out on it and simulate Zeus fittings. But what I'm going to do is get the pen with the finest possible point. I have a pen that's the smallest one that I think you can buy commercially. And I can lay them out in circles if possible, and then put the little crosshair in them. Or it's real handy to know, have some working knowledge of how these airplanes come apart. Because it seems like, so what, just put lines there, nobody will know. No, the people that really know, those are the ones that it's hard to impress, and it
It's real easy to impress people that don't know how a plane comes apart, but I'd like to get something similar on the Zeus fittings, but I need that microfine pen.
You can see how detailed Al Rabe made the nose of his plane. He did the firewall line in almost exact scale because his wing is a lot lower. I mean, this is a much more scale model, but he simulated all the Zeus fittings. We're going to try to, do the best we can, given the fact that this is not a totally scale aeroplane.
When we laid out the nose of the Seafire, we were able to get a lot of detail up on the nose. I thought that was one of the things that, the plane won 2 concourse awards. Somebody must have been fooled. Sometimes as a way of just getting ideas, it's a good idea to get some books or magazines or plans. In this case, these are plans of a real Spitfire. So you can get some idea, like in our case, I want to get the spacing similar. I don't want to have the spacing like so there's 1,000 of them here, or there's 3. I'd like to roughly get a realistic. Again, it's a mind's eye reality.
Riveting templates. John Brodak sent me these. Let's see, they're made by Top Flight. Scale template. We're to make a stunt template. But anyway, you can see what the choices are. You have various, and they're made to simulate rivets. This is a totally separate one. But you can get some real tight space rivet. These would more or less simulate rivets. This would more or less simulate Zeus fittings, I guess. And if you have, now, fuel cap is an interesting thing. You can simulate a fuel cap with this template real easily. And what's a good idea is, if you're not doing a scale model where it should be in any particular position, wait until you finish the whole model, and if you have a glitch in a wing or a spot you want to kind of detract from, that's a great place to put the gas cap. And you have to cut up these templates. In this case, I want to get this corner Zeus fitting is the most critical one. Because if this is off this way or this way, it just doesn't look right. I want to get that right in a corner. Now I have the choice of doing every other one, which would be less scale. I think we'll do every one here with the real fine pen, of a really, really fine pen. And this is where it starts to look three-dimensional. There's a real thick line, a medium line, and a fine line all in one area. Your eye is drawn to that as it's looking and to see what is the pattern here, what is the situation. When you're doing this kind of stuff, it's real important that the template not move. I've got it taped down and I hold it, and a razor, this is the smallest pen that they make, and it puts on real microfine details. Another thing you can use this pen for is when you can't get a corner to come to a point. Now, obviously, when you get to the end of the template, I'm going to have to move it. I'll just put it over so 2 of these overlap, so I maintain that alignment. It's critical to maintain that alignment.
Once that template is pulled off, now we got to go up here. I've got to continue this. So what I need to do is overlap and make sure I get these right in alignment. Boy, if one of these is off even the thickness of a pen line, it looks, well, looks wrong. Always use the tape. Once that dries, I always give it a second to dry and then just remove the template.
Now once that's totally dry, I can get the little cross pieces in there by hand, but I really like to let it dry, totally dry, because one little touch and it smears. I laid out the second half, still need to put in a little cross hairs, and I need to lay them out on this parting line up the top. There's always Zeus fittings on that line too. The real Miss Ashley, that of course the Zeus fittings are only on the side facing the spinner. So we can simulate them, and they are, well, this must be a permanent panel. I can't figure that part of it out, but we'll do just what it is on the picture. At a plan of a Spitfire, what I see, and it doesn't show well on that picture, is there's Zeus fittings on one side because this panel's removable, and this side is rivet heads. So we have both. We can simulate that whole thing. The Zeus fittings are on one side, and on this panel, the rivets are only on the inside.
On this side, again, I've used the smaller ones, so it adds some variety. Otherwise, what I think happens is if you just put dots everywhere, it just, I don't know, it doesn't add much as much interest as when you vary the spacing, vary the size, and vary the thickness of the line. It all adds up into adding interest to the project.
Now, you can do this with a little template. I don't think it's important enough. I just kind of laid them in by hand. I try to vary the angle because they don't all tighten up exactly equally, that's for sure. Like when, exactly the same as when you put screws in. At least the ones on our, the air coupe that I owned, they never tightened up right. Again, this adds a little interest. I like the way this looks.
Now with these, I did them a little bit differently. But the overall look is one that I'm happy with.
I always like to have some riveting details, and I do these freehand. Try to keep the rivets equally spaced, obviously, if possible. But around a canopy, they're very effective. Adds a little detail, and of course they'll get covered with many a coats of clear. Anyway, when you hold the two fuselages together, the one that has the ink and the one that doesn't, wow, it's night and day difference for a paltry 20 hours of inking.
As a reference point, before I start on a second fuselage, look at the difference in, I don't know, it just looks so much nicer with the ink on it. I mean, it's a question of night and day nicer. Obviously, the next thing is do the other one. What I'll do is, I'll do the other one off camera, but I'm just basically trying to match up everything so that they're very similar. But if I find something I like, or would like to change or add or whatever, I'm free to do it. That's one of the, I guess, one of the nice things about having two of these to work with. Now, needless to say, the second one took a lot less time than the first one because I already had planned out what I wanted to do. Again, it might be of some value when you, you know, that you can copy these lines for even for a Cardinal or a Strager or whatever. Well, like in Paul Walker, in Paul Winter's case, the Voodoo that he's making, these would be pretty prototypical ink lines. One of the next things I want to do, of course, I want to put the bottom block on. I want to put this together in pieces because, for instance, one of the things has to happen is this ink line has to get continued down onto the bottom block. The ink line in the back is okay. In fact, this is fine. And I don't know if we want to add some ink lining in the back here to make that match. But I want to have it all together in one piece. And, of course, anything that goes on the back, I need to make sure it matches both fuselages. But now that I've had this together, this is really the first time it's been together in this mode. This really looks nice. You can tell I don't have a big ego or anything, right? Of course, I'll do the same trick with the tape and try to get the line. The idea, maybe it'll help disguise that line. I don't know. If it doesn't, it's not a big deal. And the same thing I'll be able to do. Well, I don't want to have it come on an angle back here, but we'll see if we want to add any ink lining. Again, this is the part where I'm glad I have pictures of this type of plane. so I can get the stuff as prototypical as possible. Now with that ink line on there, what I want to do is continue the Zeus fittings so that it'll kind of disguise that line. Now the next thing I want to do, before I put any more ink on this, I want to take the Letrosets and lay out some of the lettering and some of the sponsor lettering that's going to go in this area, because I don't want it to get too busy. I'm going to lay this out. Another thing I always do too is spell out what I want to write, make sure I don't, not that I would ever, ever misspell anything. Okay, when you get one that didn't release properly, and believe me, Letraset is out of business, so it's not like I can call them up and complain. Notice I'm working from the right to the left because I want this part of it to be right under the canopy. And from working off of the sheet, now I need to find a P that will release. I'm referencing off of this bottom line off the top of the trim. Now on a wood fuselage, this is the wood one, isn't it? Yeah. On a wood, you want to not press any harder than you have to release the letters, or you can pre-release them on, they give you a piece of wax paper, pre-release them to the point where they just get ready to release. Now these look pretty decent. But because they're out of business, I guess a year or two from now, we're gonna have to make our own Wendy Artnowski Letrosets. You can see that when this just starts to turn from the black color of the letter to white, and I'm using a ballpoint pen, they make all kind of fancy things. I seem to like a ballpoint pen the best. The trick is to press easily, don't press down. At all costs, don't put a dent in the plane.
I want to try to simulate that little, the little emblem with ink, I guess is the easiest way. I don't have any realistic way of doing it in three or four different colors, but I can simulate it with the ink. Since it's a dark blue color on a real plane, I'll be able to do it with ink. Okay, now that's where it is on a real plane. I'm just trying to hit some of the outlines before I lay this. Gotta lay this out individually. These are these dry transfers that I got from Ken Clapson, and I'm trying to figure a spot. Frank McVillan sent me some of these a while back. You need to heat the part. I don't have a whole sheet, of course. You need to heat. The idea with this is, I'm going to try this. Since we're not doing exactly the sponsors, we can't replicate the lettering exactly. In this case, we'll try to get it. Let's try to get it down here. You're supposed to heat the part. It's not going to look good because it's red on red. I don't like that. Let's see if the champion decal goes down there. Maybe we can do that one. Maybe that champion one will. trying like heck not to put dents in this because this is the wood fuselage. Now for doing all these sponsors and things, I guess this and combination of this and Letrosets is going to just take some time and lay it out. Look at this, I don't even have the camera where it should be here. Oh, I was going to try to put this in here, which would be more scale, but it just, I laid it out, it looked too squeezed together. Looked at the photos and obviously the lettering on each side of the plane is different and the sponsors change from year to year, so I guess we have a pretty free hand here about laying out these sponsors and lettering. The other side of the plane I'm going to use the other sponsor, but on this side the Cortlandts, which is scale for a lot of the pictures. The early pictures where it has the red 38 and the Cortlandts on both sides. And the latest paint job, I think this was the final paint job here with the desethane. We're going to work on this side of the fuselage for the rest of the session. I think realistically we're just going to be able to finish one side of this fuselage today. Come back down tomorrow nice and fresh and work on the other side. Now today I managed to get the other side, well, almost finished. But even this was a whole session. Hey, you can see the difference, see, with the lettering. Oh, we got about a day and a half. I guess I put the bottom block on here. A whole nother day of lettering this puppy up. And if we run out of Letrosets, we're going to be in trouble because definitely there are no more. Whatever's in the art supply store now is all there's ever going to be. Now today I ran into several things I didn't expect. I have hundreds of sheets of Letroset, but what it is just to give you an example, is I've used up most of the letters that you need to use over and over. So in a case like some of the things that I'm trying to replicate, in other words, the easy ones, it's easy to replicate them. But when you get to some that where the, I don't have a lot of the letters and I'm missing, I'm going to have to improvise here to some degree. Now obviously, you know, if they still made Letrosets, this wouldn't be a problem. Now some of the things that I'm still looking at doing is they have a sponsor beauty rest on top of the rudder. I'm not going to be able to do that because I don't have any script. They didn't have any script in the art supply store that I went to. But I'm going to try to replicate the Levis Rogers Racing logo up there, maybe with something that from 3 feet away will look the same. Now, again, when you have two of these guys to work on, things like just replicating that in ink, everything just starts to double and triple and quadruple and whatever. But I think I'm going to sneak by because I've been really biding my time. Now, I wanted to show this. On this one, I got a pretty good replication of the desothane. That looks like it's going to work real well. And so, but I can't do it letter for letter, word for word. It just, because of not having Letrosets anymore, just gets difficult to do. And obviously we don't have anything like this thing that says room store. We're going to have to improvise on that. I've kind of made, see this little Levitz Rogers air racing team? I've kind of made my own little, again, I don't know. Improvising here is the big word. But it looks like I've got about a 3-hour session. I want to try to get all the rest of the Letrosets on. We're looking at maybe having some weather to even spray some clear on this soon. Just one thing right away, and this is really something I didn't expect. On doing the carbon, the fuselage, one of the things, no dents at all when you press on the Letrosets. And on this, because it's balsa wood, they're not pronounced, but they're certainly not perfectly flat either. And I always try to give a couple extra coats of clear where the letters are so I can smooth them out.
But a side thing, again, the carbon fuselage, you can just grind away. You can do it with an air hammer. Very, very hard, rigid shell. If you want to do rivet lines, obviously, you can just lay out a template and put a dot in the middle of it. That's one way. But when you want a custom spacing of the rivets, what I do is lay this out with a piece of tape and just mark it off in eighth-inch increments, because it's not ultra, ultra critical that you have it, you know, within a millionth of an inch. Now, in this case, I want to follow this line. Now, I don't want to go through the hatch. The hatch stays right the way it is. So you don't want to make things too unrealistic either, where a little row of rivets is a kind of subtle thing, but if you start putting rivets around every number and every, it just gets, it gets busy in a hurry. Now what I have to do is, when I get to the bottom, I want to let this dry and then wrap that right around and continue to rivet line so it goes right around the fuselage onto the other side. Really scavenging through some of these things to try to find the last little bits. Now what I tried to do, this little emblem that's up here, I wanted to put something up there. And I wound up with making up a little insignia for the Levitz Rogers Air Racing Team. Because I don't have any of the letters that match. Basically, that's a problem. Well, it's going to be a real problem that Electroset is out of business finding things that, for these little projects. In fact, I'm going to make a little attempt at trying to find another source for these. Anyway, one fuselage is basically finished. And what I'm trying to do now is I'm working on a second one, trying to get it to match, or match as close as reasonably possible. The lettering for the, what we'll call the left side of the fuselage. And all the letters, and what's happened is as I run out of letters, then I have to kind of improvise. And that gets to be challenging at best. Finishing up this side of the fuselage, and I can tell you this is a real important part of it, is I always like to put the whole plane together in the case of when I can't see the whole presentation like this. An example is when we were doing George Venturini's Tsunami, and we got all done. When we put the wing in a body, we had missed a couple of spots that really needed something. Now, in this case, I'm thinking I'm going to need something right in here when I've had this laid together, and I want to have some lettering or some ink or some rivet head. So while I'm finishing up this fuselage here, while I'm working on this guy and trying to finish up from my collection Electrosets here, while I'm trying to finish this up, I'm going to be thinking how, when I get this all put together, how this is going to look. And there's always something. See, I wound up making my own emblem, in fact, for the similar to the Levitz Rogers Racing Team. And of course, I've been keeping this right out on the, see what that little emblem looks like on the real plane? It's kind of neat. But sometimes you have to just improvise. Now I want to do this section of the fuselage next with all the lettering that's going to be on there. And we are down and out on letters, boy. We're going to have to put the push on here. Now, this working on carbon really is a lot quicker than wood. The letters just go right on because you can really press down on them. Now, notice, here's a good trick that I use. I wanted
I looked at the original one, and it was a little bit too far forward. I didn't want this white spot here, so I kind of moved the whole thing back. I like this one a lot better, and I'll transpose that lettering down. But I wanted this to end in an equal bar. I can't start it up here, because the flap will be in the way. It'll kind of look, I want it to end equally. So when you want it to end equally, the bottom line, just work from the back forward. And obviously, what I put the other fuselage up here so I wouldn't misspell anything. And just to make sure, I have the original to make sure I don't misspell anything. And I probably already misspelled something. Another little tip, and I just did this, made a mistake of, see, whenever I lay these down, I lay them down with the letters up. And I, because I'm moving around here and trying to do too many things at once, I laid it down in on the table, and it picks up all the little dust and dirt. You want to never lay these upside down, and when you store them, and I'm telling you this, and I don't do it, you should always have a sheet of wax paper on the side that the letters are on. In fact, when I get done with this, I'm going to organize this whole box. See, the problem is what I used to do is loan this box out to people. I think we're going to stop doing that right now because you can't buy these anymore. Imagine having to letter this with paint. There's no way. But anyway, the whole idea of within my circle of friends, there's very few things we don't exchange, loan, beg, borrow, steal. I don't even know what the right word is. And a lot of times things disappear. And we don't even know who to blame. But I guess that's the fun of it. If you don't have that, a good thing I have the thing up there so I can... I was going to write the word system again. You got to really... This is the kind of stuff you really have to pay attention to. I shouldn't be kidding around about it. Anyway, we're hoping we're going to, at Brodak's contest, be able to put on a real nice hands-on finishing little seminar or whatever you want to call it. John has kind of unofficially agreed to provide us with all the stuff we need. And William Nomura will hopefully provide some guns. And hopefully some people out there will pick up some good knowledge, some information. Anyway, there's such a thing with carbon that you can just do that to it. When you do that, the wood one, ooh, Jesus. I don't know. I get nervous. And from this point on, every 5 minutes I'm washing my hands, because if I were to get a fingerprint in here, I really can't get it out anyway. I really can't remove that. So we're coming up on the day when we're actually going to be able to put some clear on it. Now, once you get a coat of clear on this, then you're kind of home free all. Well, I'll tell you, nothing hurts me worse than the fact that when I was in high school and grammar school, I basically lived down at the airport, didn't pay much attention to school, didn't pay much attention to anything except airplanes, tell you the truth. And now later in life, I wish I could spell better. My wife hollers at me. People think I fooled around in school too much. And I did. But when I look back at it, I just think of some of those early models I built and how proud I was of them. Oh, my God. And I didn't even know that Tom McLean called today. I didn't even know that Tom had crashed the Crusader just before VSC and managed to get it back together and still fly it at VSC. So congratulations, Tom. Shows one of the sponsors, RB Airframes, apparently Red Baron Airframes, and I was able to get a pretty good replication of the lettering. So anytime I can add a little detail that's really totally prototypical or real close, the closer I can get, of course, the better. Now, before I finish, we'll go on to the next step. I always like to look at some of the other planes, some of the other ink lines that I've kind of liked. And, you know, whether it's pictures or whether you just happen like me to have a house full of planes, just looking around at some of the other things. See, I always liked the way the rivets looked
around the cockpit, having lots of things of interest. And even on the original Spitfire, we had a lot of little inking details, a lot of little things that added interest to the plane. But the idea is, and I guess in my case, I just come up here and I look around and I say, well, gee whiz, I can put some other details. What have I forgotten? What can I do next? Can I add a row of rivets, add a row of whatever? Still obviously have to do the wing. But looking around, just having some of these things to look at, just gives you some idea of, and the ideas that you like, write them down, you know, or replicate them. The tail on the plane, I love the tail with all the white rivets. I always thought that stood out pretty well. And the idea is to get the ink line, the ideas any way you can, from whomever you can, however you can, magazine pictures, videos, friends, planes, whatever. It doesn't really matter. Just get them. Things I liked, for instance, on the Red Baron was, if you don't have trim, and in this case we have trim on a flask, but if you don't have trim, laying out the ailerons and the aileron ribs, that kind of, I thought that was kind of effective. You know, on Strega, you really can't go crazy with trim because basically we have trim painted, and well, similar to this. So we're going to have to be a little more creative about laying some stuff out. Now, Evergreen Performance, I wasn't able to get a real good replication of that, but I did wind up getting something that, well, just adds some interest to it one way or another when you look at it from several different angles. What I tried to do here is just lay the parts together without even screwing them together, just to get some idea of where I might want to add some trim, or if some of the ink lines weren't exactly how I wanted them. This part I'm real happy with. I need to figure out if I want to add some lettering or some ink to the wing, and by having it all together, and it's, you see, it's not even squeezed together, it's just laid here in place. You can see the gap. I don't want to spend a half an hour bolting it together. I just want to get a look at how what I've already done is going to look when it's all put together. And the trick is to look at it from several different angles. Get a look at if it's what's in your mind's eye, and if it isn't, obviously to change it. I like the way all that little stuff on a side came out. I was happy with that. And we just made it on a desothane lettering, and all the little things over there. This side, you want to add a few lines of white ink. This is the ink that I use, and believe me, see, you need to put a couple of drops of alcohol in to thin it out. It says 3080 waterproof for paper and film. Now, there's a couple of things with white ink that's totally different than black ink. White ink has pigment, not dye. So when you lay a line on, what happens is that line is now higher than the area around it, and it tends to scrub off. So you notice that I've left the white ink for the last possible thing, because as soon as I get it done, is the next possible minute, I'd like to get a coat of clear on it, 5 minutes after it's dry. Now what'll happen is after, here's a couple of tips that'll really help you out. First, wipe the part totally clean. If necessary, put on talcum powder until you can get the ink to lay down nice. The other problem is, once you go over it, if you see it that it isn't sticking, go back over it while it's wet. Don't wait till it dries. Go over it while it's wet, go over it while it's wet, go over it while it's wet. Now, once it's totally dried, and of course, now I like to be real careful about using the white ink. It's very easy to make mistakes. In fact, it's the first ink line I've, can you believe this? I've got a little spot there. Anyway,
But it does add a lot of nice interest, especially if you have black trim or dark colors. You can kind of improvise. Now I'm using the same part, but I'm moving it back down just for the simple reason so it doesn't look like I used the same part over and over again. But I can somehow make use of this and simulate the little ailerons on here. Same way, but the trick is get it on wet, let it dry and don't touch it, and get a coat of clear on it. Remember that template that we used for the black ink up on the fuselage? Well, it just happens that it kind of fits right in here. And it adds some interest in an area that normally would be... See, I don't like having this area so busy and there's absolutely nothing here. I need this. And somehow, and this is just part of looking at it. There's no other way I know of to do this other than to just look at it, kind of fudge it and say, a little busier here, not so busy. And in the end, that's really the only way I know of that you can do this.
And one of the finicky parts of this is I want to have this line obviously line up perfectly with the other side. By the way, just I don't know if I've made it clear about the white ink. The white ink is really difficult to use because it's really not made to go over paint. And I've tried a lot of ways of making it easier. There's really no other way to make it easier. Just got to tough it out, I guess. Now, in my case, I just try to get the pen to start flowing ink before I lay the template out. And because it takes time, see, it would be easy if you could lay out all the templates and just go right through. But each time you let the pen dry out, what happens, it takes time to get it flowing again. Once you finally do get the pen going, then sometimes it just drools all over you. Anyway, mastering white ink is a little bit more work than black ink, but in our case, I think it just adds that extra little thing that separates the planes that are all up in those front rows. It just separates them into, oh, that one has something extra. Now I gotta make sure, and I will make sure, let me get this matched up on the end.
You get that little microscopic little tail on there, just let it dry. Don't try to rush it and smudge it off. Let it dry totally and just get in there with a razor and shave it off. Just a little touch of a razor tip. Now see this one here, we could even use, and I'll try to make sure it's dry. The trick is, as soon as you're done with the white ink, get a coat of clear on it. Otherwise, it's very vulnerable. As soon as you touch it with your hand, it'll smudge. Unlike black ink, it's just a little more finicky to use, but boy, if you're talking about having a little extra something to set your plane apart from the crowd. Now, a line of rivets you can easily use, and I don't even have to tape it down. A machinist ruler, or just make your own machinist ruler. A piece of 1/64 plywood is okay. Mark up even rivet spacings. White makes excellent rivets. If you're willing and patient to put in the time to, and usually you have to go over them twice. Keep the pen moving. What happens, it adds a little interest, and you can use that to your advantage. Now before I get too many things ahead of myself here, I want to get a coat of clear on everything. What happens is you're always tempted, at least I am, to get too much on there, and then it just gets too busy. I don't like that either. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to, and it looks like we'll have a day we can get some paint to dry.
I'm going to mix up the clear that's going to go on the plane. 1/4 clear, 1/4 thinner, and that's all the clear that's going to go on this, and then from that point I'll just add thinner. Like hell to get just 1/4 clear. I'm going to try get most of it on the bottom, a lot of it over anywhere there's a line. In other words, anywhere there's an edge or an ink line, I want to get extra. But the first thing I want to do is get one very thin coat on all the parts, on everything, so it seals up and it'll keep my fingerprints from destroying this stuff. Got the first decision to make is I want to keep the first coat relatively dry. I don't want to have it go on super wet, so I just want to lay on a coat. I don't want to bleed those ink lines down. And I also want to see what the humidity is in the air and see if I need to add any retarder. Now, because this gun puts on such a nice coat of paint, it's ridiculous. And nice that paint lays down. Now, I don't want to get it any wetter than that. Again, I'm always starting with the little baby parts and work up to the bigger and bigger parts. I found out about this gun. This is William Nomura's product, gun, whatever you want to call it. This thing lays down such a nice coat. I'm really anticipating saving a lot of time and energy, a lot of money, on all the sand out. I mean, this is the first coat of clear, so when it lays down like that, you know you're not going to have a lot of sanding to do. You're not going to have a lot of problems. But of course, the other criteria here is I want to keep the paint to an absolute minimum. I'm trying to get on one really, really thin level coat after another, and I think this gun is going to help me do it. This gun, really, I wish I had this years ago. I'm going to have to put the parts right in the garage because the wind is really blowing here. In fact, leaves are blowing around and I don't want to get anything stuck in this. But that's a real nice coat for the first coat of clear. Had a combination of having Brodak dope and this real good quality gun is really making this part of the job real easy. Looks like we're not going to have to deal with any retarder today, and if that's the case, I don't want any in there. Without retarder, there's less chance you're going to melt the canopy or melt ink lines or anything like that. And because these shells are carbon fiber, I don't have to paint the inside either. That's another saving. For if it were wood, you'd have to seal everything up inside. Objective here is to get a coat on the canopy and all the lettering. A dry coat. I don't want to bury it in clear right now. Just get a dry coat on everything. Especially the canopy. Don't get the canopy too wet on the first coat. All those lesser sets. Now this is the wooden fuselage, so obviously this one we do have to put some paint inside, just in case some oil gets in there. I left a little canopy in place so that clear wouldn't spray in into the cockpit. But the idea is to get everything sealed up with one coat. Now on this, I guess when you bake a take-apart plane or plane to flap smoke, at least I can get the outer part. And as I'm working my way up toward the center, I want to get extra on all the edges, extra on the ink lines, extra on the paint stripes.
Amazing day. We need no retarder at all here. It looks like everything's drying up like a champ. And anytime you can avoid using retarder, it gives you a little more built-in safety factor of melting a canopy or something.
Now, if you can see the color that's coming through as you get the clear on this red, the color really gets bright. Again, trying to get extra up on the stripes, extra around the edges. And I have to leave the little spot in but where my finger is holding this. Test to see how dry this first coat is going on. This is what it dries like on my hand. So obviously the second coat, we're going to add a little thinner to it. This is just dried overspray, but that gun atomizes so well, you really get a nice, it really lays the dope out beautifully. But you see this and you know that's a little bit on the dry side, and that's what we want for that first coat over the electrosets and the canopy. Now on a part like this, what I want to do is, I want to get, cover all the edges, all of the spots where, boy, the wind is starting to really blow. Yeah, I heard a squeak, the fuselage, maybe you can even hear it on the video, the fuselage was sliding off the table from the wind blowing. Anyway, I try to leave the wing till last because it's so difficult to paint when the wind is blowing. I'm going to kind of wait until maybe I can get a gap in this wind. The Anaheim winds are blowing. Now this, almost this whole part needs to be done. Just trying to give extra anywhere there's a line. I want to see how this color, this Brodak Candy Apple Blue, is going to pop once you put some clear on it. Now I don't know because everybody's TV is adjusted for different color blends, but I can tell you from this end, this is about the reddest red I've ever seen. Yeah, I think, just an idea, I think that's going to be a real popular color, that blue. I don't know if you can pick that up on your TV screen, but that is a beautiful blue. Of course, this is the carbon fuselage. I don't have to concern myself with fuel proofing anything inside, other than a little piece of balsa wood by the pipe tunnel. Now, I'm almost at the end. I only have to do the wing. I don't know how much more tape we have left. I have a bad habit of running out of tape lately. I get so engrossed in this project, I don't keep track of the tape. Now, as I'm starting to shoot the wing, you see the humidity on the wingtip? What's happening is the temperature's dropping. And the humidity is right on the air now. So I'm going to go throw a little retarder, just maybe a cup full of retarder
5-10% in here, so I don't have to deal with that. Now even just that little bit of retarder is going to make a difference. You do not want to see this fog up at this point in time. Want that to lay down. See how nice and bright that Brodak Gold is too.
I know we're almost at the end of this tape, so I'm not going to get too cute here. But we did get the first coat on. And obviously I want this to dry 24 hours, at least a whole day, before I touch this again.
Now, as tempting as it can be to want to get a second coat on this today, a second full coat, I know ultimately it's the best is when this dries out at least 24 hours. And since we have yard work to do tomorrow, we're getting our yard in shape. We're going to let this sit out here and tomorrow bring it in the house. But I got to get it to gas off out here a good 24 hours. And I've been tempted many times, just rush, but you always pay later on. And with everything hanging up, just let it dry. That's, to me, that's the best investment in the world right now. Getting used to this gun, we're really, really getting comfortable with it, and I can see there's a gain to be had from having this real good high-end equipment. We get up this morning, I'm ready to go outside and get... Yesterday we were in a t-shirt. We were painting in a t-shirt. This morning we get up, it's 25 degrees and it's snowing. So what I'm going to do, obviously, now this, I'm going to try to use this to my advantage, as I always do. What I'm going to try to do is bring all the parts in here. I jacked the heat up in the house because that's been out in a cold garage all night. And it's always good to hang it up by the heating vent. Let it sit up there. Give it a day at the heating vent. Now, despite the snow, we brought everything in. And there's a key, a good little tip here is, I'm always prone to rush and get that second coat of clearing. But because we have a snowstorm, I'll be shoveling snow at a bunch of different properties that I have to maintain. And what's going to happen here is it'll get a couple extra days of drying out, which certainly won't hurt. Unexpected. Now you can see we got, as I'm looking at this, this is right on the verge of having a humidity problem here. Right there, that'll come out, that's no problem. But if it doesn't, I'll just really lightly sand that down and get a nice coat of clear with a little retarder in it. Anyway, to finish on this, real nice. For one coat of clear, that's fine. And always extra clear on here. And the big open spots like here, where there's no inclines, you don't need a whole lot. The tail section, I'm just looking this over. Anyway, we've reached another little milestone in the snowy world of Windy. And I was really hoping, I'll tell you in my heart of hearts, that we would be having some more 70, 80 degree weather. It ain't gonna happen. We're back to having snow for the next couple of days anyway. So I hope you've enjoyed the tape. I hope you've gotten some good information. Please share it, of course, and please share all the fun of this event. Now, I like to go back and forth looking at the different areas of the plane that I think maybe could add a little more, or tell you the truth, I think we've got it pretty close to what I had originally envisioned for this project. I'll just look into your eyes. So warm, so
Hey again, thanks for joining us.
Of the world.